Hi all, Shane here, Longman 67. I'm going to do something a bit different. I'm going to be doing a series of videos, which I'm going to call Trouble in the Colonies, or The Troublesome 13, which basically is going to cover my project and a bit of history about the American War of Independence, which I'm going to be modelling a battalion of British line infantrymen, and so I'm kind of get into the history, and it's going to be for gaming projects, so I'm going to be like rewriting, I'm going to be replaying certain battles from history and trying to recreate them. So so I'm going to start off with just a quick introduction to, also it's going to be updates to my 6mm project. So you can see here, this is my first update on my 6mm army, and I'm going to tie into a bit of history behind this. So, as being an Irish man, I'll always try to model an Irish regiment whenever possible, as it's my kind of my heritage, and so I always kind of find it easier to connect with Irish subjects, and I always find it interesting to see how Irishmen felt and behaved in the British Army during this time, because Ireland's it wasn't the most pleasant of countries to live in at the time, but that's here or there. So basically, I will be modelling the 18th Regiment of Foot, which is an Irish regiment raised from Clonmel in the south of Ireland. So this tray here of 6mm guys is my battalion HQ. So these are the Baccus 6mm troops. The chap in the middle, he is meant to be, well, he's the regimental commander, but I'm just going to say he's the brigade or the battalion, he's over his battalion. So he's meant to represent Lieutenant Colonel John Wilkins, which he was the commander of the 18th Regiment of Foot, which was the Royal Irish, which is to this day the regiment is still going. They're stationed up in Northern Ireland now, not too far outside Belfast or Derry, I think. So by the time they were raised by the Earl of Granard in 1684, and they were like put together from various militia groups and free companies. But this is going to represent the 18th Regiment of Foot in North America, and represent them during the War of Independence, or the Revolutionary War, or whatever you want to call it. So I'm just going to talk really quickly on what I did with these figures. So I'm going to be doing some tutorials on painting 6mm soon. This was just my first time doing it, so I didn't want to make a tutorial. So they're actually a very easy model to paint. Like, even though like here's my lighter in scale to it, so like, yeah, they're tiny. They are literally 6mm tall, as the name might suggest. So they're very easy to paint. Just good lighting is essential, and nothing to worry about. And this camera is not quite doing them justice. I actually think I've moved them out of focus. There we go. So so this is representing the 18th Regiment, Irish, Royal Irish. So I'll talk you through them. So at the moment I just have the guy in the centre with the wig, the white wig. It's meant to be Lieutenant Colonel John Wilkins, the commander of the Royal Irish at this time. And two chaps either side of him could be his aide-de-coms or his lieutenants or captains. In the game, the rule set I'll be using, which will be black powder, I'm just going to be using him as a battalion commander. But if I do go to regimental and brigade level games, which I might do in time when my collection gets big enough, he'll be being played as a man himself. So I'm just going to do a quick 360 spin. Now we need to buy a turntable. So, not too difficult. Everything was just blocked in, and then a small wash and some highlights on their sleeves, on their tunics, and that's about it. So, I'll give you some history about the 18th Regiment of Foot. the Royal Irish. So they were formed in 1684 by the Earl of Granard from local militias and free companies. The regiment was first deployed to America on the 1st of January 1767 and arrived at Philadelphia on the 1st or the 11th of July 1767. So there was about a 5 month period in between their readiness order to deploy over to North America and their arrival, so that would have been included. At the time, it's a little bit sketchy, the strength of the Royal Irish at this time. They needed a draft. In the 1700s, the military term draft was not to conscript, but was to merge units from other regiments. So you could draft, say, a company from one regiment, a company from another, to help bring up the strength of another regiment. So the Royal Irish had to draft detachments and companies and elements from at least six other regiments before they set over. So they were quite under strength before they went over. So when they arrived, I'm awful popular today for some reason. My apologies. So when they arrived on the 11th of July, 1767, in Philadelphia. So the regiment would spend quite a significant amount of time in Philly till 1776. So they were there for, they were there for almost like 9 years or 11 years. When they were relocated to Illinois, and they would remain at Fort Chartiers, which was formerly a French fort that was handed over to the British at the end of the Seven Years' War, which would be the French-Canadian War or the French-Indian War to the rest of us, as in the conflict that is portrayed in Last of the Mohicans. The regiment then will remain at Illinois up until 1776. So they redeployed to Boston, and a small detachment, about company strength, gets sent to Detroit as well. The entire time the regiment is sending detachments all over the place. They're never really concentrated in strength in any way, shape or form. At the outbreak of hostilities in 1775, the first battle of the Revolutionary War on the 19th of April, which is the Battle of Lexington and Concord, all fought on the same day, the Royal Irish's Grenadier Company is present for the first three major battles of the War of Independence. So they take part in the Battle of Lexington and Concord, which is on the 17th of April, 1775, in Middlesex County, Massachusetts, or the province of Massachusetts Bay. Then later on, they will take part in the Battle of Bunker Hill, which is the first major engagement of the War of Independence. Concord and Lexington, or Lexington and Concord, should I say, are more like, they're more skirmishes. Like they do turn into quite vicious fights, but they're not. Both sides do not commit in strength. I will actually go into detail on the battles of Concord and Lexington in the next couple of videos. They were more just sorties. There were counterinsurgency sorties by the British to destroy weapon caches. So they weren't full-pitched engagements, whereas the Battle of Bunker Hill, which ironically, the Battle of Bunker Hill did not actually take part on Bunker Hill, it took part on the adjacent hill called Breed's Hill. But the reason why the battle was named after Bunker Hill and not Breed's Hill was that Bunker Hill was the original objective for both the Continental Army, or the Rebels, and the British regulars. So it just stuck. And also, like, I think this Bunker Hill has a bit of a ring to it, so... So they took part on Bunker Hill, which was on the 17th of June, 1775. That was a full-pitch engagement where the Patriots and Rebels were dug in, and the Brits had to dig them out of fortified hills during the siege of Boston. With Royal Naval support, as in the Royal Navy pulled up their men of wars and frigates and started blasting Boston and surrounding hills with cannon fire. Now it sounds a lot more impressive than it actually was. Bear in mind, artillery and cannonade at the time wasn't the most accurate of weaponry. so they couldn't really be used for precision suppression of enemy positions. It was just more for, well, just to keep their heads down and do a bit of damage. But it was a pretty aggressive fight and very bloody Battle of Bunker Hill, which I'll also go into the detail about in another video. Ironically, the battles of Concord, or Lexington, Concord, and Bunker Hill were the Royal Irish's first formal engagement in almost 50 years. They had actually not taken part in a full pitched engagement for 50 years. But for a unit that was quite perhaps inexperienced compared to the other line regiments who would have fought quite a lot in the Seven Years' War and the French Indian War, they actually executed themselves quite well. From a source, which is the Canon, according with the sources, Canon's Regimental History, they put the losses of the Royal Irish at Lexington and Concord as 2 killed in action and 4 wounded, and at Bunker Hill 3 killed in action and 8 wounded. So they did quite well for themselves, and especially for Bunker Hill, because Bunker Hill was very vicious and the British actually sustained a lot of casualties, which we'll go into later on. They don't really seem to play a big role after Bunker Hill. Now, what I mean by that is that the Royal Irish as themselves do not play a big role, because in 1775 they are merged or drafted into the King's Regiment in Detroit. So we'll actually look on at that later on, because I don't want to be too overwhelming. So meaning that I think it was an American provincial regiment, the Royal Irish, and another line infantry regiment all got merged into the King's Regiment. And the reason for that was a lot of the regiments in North America and the 13 colonies were under strength, and they were quite badly under strength because, well, they were so far from their lines of communication and resupply, it would take months, if not years, to get replacements. And this is actually one of the reasons why the British lose the War of Independence, is that especially when other European armies such as the French get involved, and the Spanish and Dutch, they all do certain things in different capacities. It's just that the British army can no longer sustain itself to fight and replace its losses. That was the main thing, and also their supply lines would be strangled. So it was very important that they were quite ingenious with their, or showed a good level of resourcefulness with their assets. So what they would do was that they'd form merged units to help. Instead of having a series of understrength regiments, they would try to make one full-strength regiment. So this is what happened to the Royal Irish and a few other regiments in 1775. So that's just a bit of a drone of history, but it just kind of helps, and it helps me too when I'm painting these guys to have a little bit of understand about them. And now I'll actually talk a little bit what I did here, okay? So what I did for these guys was, first I mounted them onto a strip, like I'll show you here, because I'm working on my Grenadier company at the moment. I'm going to pull these guys away. So I mounted them onto a strip like so, sprayed them Vallejo surface primer black with my airbrush, okay, tinned it down slightly, because this is such a small scale that you don't want to risk losing your detail. Sorry. So just give it a quick spray, let it dry for a few hours, and then I picked out their uniforms with Citadel Mephiston Red, which is a lovely, deep, almost crimson. It's beautiful, I love that colour, such a rich, and because bear in mind, in the 1770s, your uniforms aren't going to be blood red, they're going to be faded from wear and tear and time in the field. So I always like having them having like a deep red rather than a real bright red. So first thing is I blocked in their uniforms, then I blocked in the cuffs, which was done, I painted them in gold, but it was just too much in the scale, so I went back and painted them in Avaland Sunset, which is my favourite yellow colour from Citadel. It's a really lovely, deep, mustard-like yellow, beautiful colour. And so I repainted them that. Then I painted their faces in Bestigor flesh, again from Citadel. A nice dark flesh tone. I avoided the shadowed areas around the eyes and mouth, just to kind of add a bit of depth, as you can kind of see there with the battalion commander, with Lieutenant Colonel Wilkins. And then I went back in the paint. As an officer at the time, I used to wear wigs, almost like how a judge would wear them in a courtroom. So I painted the wigs, painted in the sashes and the cartridge kind of scabbard belt, if you will, which is the white sash running down the flag bearers and the two captains' shoulders, which is for their scabbards and also for the cartridge boxes. Then once everything was blocked in, I hit it with a wash of MIG Octolong Shadow Brown. It's a very light wash, let it dry. And then I went back and highlighted certain areas. So I highlighted a little pointy stick. So I highlighted the upper arm areas with blood red from Citadel again, just to make it pop a little bit. Then I went back and did the trim for their hats, the white trim on the top of the hat, and did the reins for the horses. And I also then did a little bit of detail work on the horses, that I'd give them a light grey highlight, because they're black horses, and give them, it's kind of hard to see, but I actually put little white kind of spots on their muzzles, just to give them a bit of detail. And that was actually it then. Then I matte coated them, sprayed matte, Vallejo matte varnish, tinned with ultimate thinner. What I did then was that I mounted them on the bases, which are the lovely laser cut bases that came with it, that lovely smoked wood smell. And what I did was, if anyone's familiar with like steel, like any kind of wargaming figure, that they come with a cast base, and if you just glue it onto a base, paint it and flock it, you'll have a slight raise. So in order to avoid that, I actually put gravel or sand just around them, let it dry, and then use various colours of flock to build up, so it's like they're on a slight rise, and it helps blend them into the base. And that's that. So it took me about, maybe in between working on the Grenadiers, it took me about 2 hours to paint these boys up. And that's like in between working with the Grenadiers. So like they're very easy to paint. Anyone who's like looking into this scale and is a little bit unsure, can they do it? It's very easy. The only thing I'd recommend, and I'll do a few more live painting sessions with this as well, keep your area well lit. If you don't, you will go blind. I'll guarantee you that within a couple of months or a couple of years, you'll notice your sight starts to fail you. So well lighting, and like I don't work under this light. I actually have the piece directly under the center of my light, which is a bit more located to my right, and I have it right down about maybe 6 inches above the piece, and I have the piece up on a cardboard box, so there's only like a 6-inch gap between, or a bit more, it's about maybe a 9-inch gap between the light source and the model. So that means it's not going to blind me, and I also have optics built into that if I need it. So that's my biggest thing I'd recommend. Just make sure you're well lit. Any other points? It's also a very good exercise in the production line style of painting. As you will see with my Grenadiers, I'm just going to remove these lads for a moment. It is production line. So I'm just painting in the gold details of their meters or meters. And it's the same along the line. I have to do some touch-up work here and there. So they don't look like much now, but when I start adding details to them, they will. So that'll be the next video when I have those done, and then I have another line, battalion or company to do, shall I say. And then just add a bit of colour variation to this little British battalion. I'll actually add, which I'll be taking a bit of creative license, but I'll be adding a company from Heiser Castle, which is the German assassins, if you will. These were the German mercenaries, they're not really mercenaries, they were sanctioned troops by the border princes of Germany, who were cousins of the royal family, as the British army was so undermanned that they actually sent over battalions of German troops. And they have a very different flavour of uniform. They're like lovely green uniforms. So I'm actually going to add a battalion of Heise Kassel troops, or Kassel troops, or Assassins, depending how you want to say them. So I haven't ordered them yet, so there'll be at least three regiments of three companies of British. So it'll be one company of Grenadiers, two companies of Line, one German company, and probably a detachment of 6-pounders, which again is a little bit of historical or a historical artistic license, but again, guns were often detached from batteries to provide support for smaller units, as in, you know, I mean, a battery might supply one gun and its crew and a limber just to supply a battalion on an expedition with some fire support. So it is known to happen. So again, I hope you found this interesting. I hope you found my waffling. For once, I actually stayed on topic, which is brilliant. I just want to say a big thank you as well. I was very lucky to, I was chatting away to Carlos Mendez there last night, and I'm just saying I really enjoyed chatting to you, mate. Absolutely great guy to speak to, really nice, really polite, and it's really cool. And I'm sorry I had to kind of, I went quiet all of a sudden. It's just that I got I had to kind of leave the conversation abruptly, and I don't want to make it look like I'm sorry, that's a bit rude of me, and I don't want to make it look, I don't want you to feel that I had lost interest. I most definitely had not. And I was also talking to Tactical Jackalope at the same time for a few minutes too. So great guys, and I hope to talk to them again really soon. So I just thought I'd throw that in. And I'm going to sign off now. Thank you for listening to me Babylon. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you liked the little history lesson. The next video will be continuing on with the Grenadiers and a little bit about the Battle of Lexington, Concord and Bunker Hill, of which the 18th foot Grenadiers took part in, and we'll resume our little series with that. So thank you so much for watching. Take care of each other. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. Take care of each other, watch out for those buses, and I'll talk to you all very soon. Bye bye.